It is preeminently the responsibility of Mr. George Bush, as chairman of the Republican National Committee, to plot a course for the Republican Party throughout this summer and fall. The objective is the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November, when one-third of the U.S. Senate will be reelected and all of the House of Representatives. The going thus far has been tough. Only one Republican victory in five traditionally Republican districts during the by-elections of this past season. And the conventional explanation is Watergate. Mr. Elliot Richardson, appearing on this program last December, put it this way, that, quotes, the future of the party is certainly inseparable from a public verdict on the Nixon administration. George Bush needs to maneuver the party's way across those shoals. Mr. Bush, the son of the late Senator Prescott Bush, went to Phillips Academy at Andover, and then right away into the Navy, where for a while he was the youngest fighter pilot in America. He flew over a period of 3 years and was shot down once, spending hours in the water in the Pacific, where he was finally rescued by a submarine. He won four decorations and matriculated at Yale, where he was captain of the champion baseball team and a Phi Beta Kappa in economics. He went to Texas to make his fortune, and characteristically did. Turning his attention to politics, he lost a Senate race, won two congressional races, lost a second Senate race, and then suddenly was appointed by President Nixon as our ambassador to the United Nations. There he spent two turbulent years, during which we lost the China vote, and just after the Nixon landslide in 1972, he accepted appointment as chairman of the Republican National Committee, in which capacity he is still serving time. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Bush whether there is a plausible explanation for recent Republican losses other than Watergate.
Yeah. In the most recent election, Michigan's 8th congressional district, we lost in a very narrow 1.5 point spread. And in Bay County, which is a heavily industrialized, heavy voting part of that district, we lost by 11,000 votes. Traditionally, we lose in that area, but by 2,000 or 3,000 votes. And unemployment, got different figures on it, was a minimum of 12%. Some say as high as 14% to 16%. It's automotive related. Clearly, that hurt us. I'm not saying Watergate didn't hurt us. I'm saying that economics have determined elections in the past. They're going to determine elections in the future. When you have unacceptable rates of unemployment or inflation, both of which were present, they were bad. Energy hurt us in the earlier elections, not so much in the last one. And Watergate and its all its connotations there, too, hurt us.
So that the voters are blaming Mr. Nixon not only for Watergate, but also for the downturn in the economy.
I think that's a fair statement. We measure each election. After the election, we go in there, we've gone in there, or somebody's gone in there and polled it. And those three issues, energy, Watergate, and the economy, prove to be factors that cause people to vote for Democrats. Now, I don't think they thought it through very carefully. What you don't need is one more Democrat to help solve the economic problems, but they did take it out on the Republicans, and I think not because of the Republicans in Congress, but because of what they perceived to be unacceptable solutions to the administration at that point in history, at that time.
Of course, we take the position that no Democrat has thought things through very carefully, don't we?
Well, I think that's a position that I might offer an amendment to, say very few, but not too many in terms of economic policy or what is perceived to be the national economic policy of the Democrats.
Well, to dispose of the economic situation, surely your committee has conducted polls tending to try to establish what it is that the voters are unhappy about. Now, to be unhappy about something is not necessarily to desire a particular solution to it, right? They would like less inflation, but do they come out in favor of certain a certain methods of reducing inflation, or do they just, is it an undifferentiated
I'm not sure that in terms of any polls that we've done that you get that much depth. I think it could be done. I haven't seen any that are done. I know at one juncture there was massive support in this country for controls. It transcended the traditional lines of liberal Democrats advocating them and Republicans being opposed to them. And I would think today, however, if that were surveyed, given the experience that the country's had with controls, so somebody can see it, that it wouldn't be, people wouldn't want to go down that road again. Similarly, in the energy question, the polls that I saw in the winter when we were concerned about energy, it just certainly is a national issue, but again, in my job, from a partisan political issue, and it affected us in some of these elections, the people, by rather substantial numbers, showed they wanted rationing. And yet, I think the administration, though it may have hurt in, you know, instant popularity in a Johnstown, Pennsylvania election may hurt us, I think they were proper to resist rationing. The Democrats, so I don't really know the answer, Bill, as to what what the people are saying the option should be. My own judgment is, in terms of something as fundamental as controls, they're moving away from that rather than towards it, and certainly Republicans are.
Well, now, there has, of course, been a lot of talk about Mr. Nixon as an albatross. Is it your judgment that if Mr. Nixon were to decide tonight that he wanted to become a poet or whatever, and eliminate himself without any sort of residual stigma, under such circumstances as those, would you project that the party would have an easier time in November?
Well, you're not going to like this answer because I know of your intellectual alacrity, but I am not going to get into these hypotheses because this isn't going to happen. He's not, I know, and respect the views of a very distinguished senator from New York named Buckley, who I read carefully what he said. I also sort of saw what his brother said in Kansas City and read it. I think so much of that depends, if I were going to delve into the hypothetical world, I think a lot would depend on how that came about. Mm-hmm. Because my view is it's wrong for the president to resign. It's wrong for him to be forced out of office. The system's got to work. The system will work in fairness. And I remain rather convinced that the system will not compel the president to leave office. And if I were going to try to give you as frank an answer as I could on it, I'd have to say, well, it all depends. Depends what the facts are that accompany this, and I just don't think it's worth speculating, because whatever else we talk about, that's the thing that's going to be highlighted around, that the national chairman is speculating on the president's, you know, what'll happen to the president leaves office, and I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah.
So I hate to be
I understand you.
Fend you off. But
I understand your problem. I had it in Kansas City. and obviously you read a synoptic version of what I said there, which was, it turned out not to have been very accurate. Professor Hugh Kenner says that the press is a low-definitional media, and you should not attempt to communicate any subtlety if it depends on the correct placement of a comma. But later on in the week, I started putting it this way, and I'm not pushing you to accept the hypothesis.
No, go ahead.
But I'm suggesting the following conceivable spectrum. At one end, Mr. Nixon appears, and he says, I'm addressing myself now to the people who voted for me in 1972. They voted for me to further certain ends that they desire and I desire in America. Several things have happened. One, there's been a collision course gestating over a period of generation between Congress and the president. Secondly, some people, anxious for my re-election, pursued a zealous program, which quite correctly has offended the people. Third, I invited the Congress and the judiciary to use all of their resources to get to the bottom of the story while accepting a responsibility. Now, I am uniquely situated to judge whether my continuation in office furthers these interests. And I am telling you, this is he talking, that the time has come where I think the country would be better off, and I beg of you not to be acrimonious, not to have any, not to indulge any unproductive bitterness towards the people who criticize me, to give all of your support to my successor. I'm leaving in as a gesture of loyalty to you who voted me and as a gesture of competence to the man I selected above all to be my successor. That would be one version. Now, way at the other end is a version in which he appears and he says, okay, those bastards have got me. The press is really, and the media are controlling this country. I have given up on American justice, given up on American democracy. I make no future commitments to the viability of the American republic, and I am quitting and let the media run this damn expletive country from now on. Now, if he resigned under that rubric, the country would be much worse off than it is now. If he resigned under the former, the country could conceivably be better off. If he said it would be better off.
Yeah. That's close to what your senator, the senator said, I think. Senator Buckley said, isn't it?
He stressed voluntary resignation.
Yeah.
But of course, there's a sense in which even if you describe that, you become a part of the juggernaut.
Yeah, I get you. Yeah. I get you.
Now, in between here and here is any number of variables. And I guess what I want to ask you, whether you would want to comment on, is assuming that Mr. Nixon, sua sponte, came to the decision that he'd be better off, you'd have to accept it, wouldn't you?
Well, I think...
I mean, you wouldn't then say, oh, please don't.
Well, I think I would accept it, but it isn't going to happen. That's the thing that I think... I don't profess to be the world's closest person to the president in understanding his instincts and everything else, but I am close enough to feel that that will not happen under any circumstance. Mm-hmm. So I would rather not speculate on something I feel that deeply convinced about.
You say it's like saying, oh, what if the Pope became a Seventh-day Adventist?
Well, someone... I just don't think that's going to... I don't think it's in the makeup of the man. And I've seen the president a good deal lately, and I just don't feel that is that's an option.
Yeah.
Let's talk about something else.
Okay.
Although one can speculate, and I think honestly so. I remember when your brother, after a lot of real soul searching, reached his decision. He did something that I will not forget because I still am. Even in a rather uncivil world we're living in, appreciate civil gestures. And he called me up. I was down hustling money for the Republican Party in Florida at the time. I was working. And he very thoughtfully told me what he was fixing to do and explained it. And I told him I had great respect for his decision. I just happened to think it was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's room for discussion of these things, honest debate on it, but I am locked in my thinking into a position that he's not going to do that, the president isn't going to do it, and therefore it doesn't help the job I'm in to speculate on it.
Okay.
I've got a tough enough job anyway, and I know that's not what this program's about.
Sure.
And you probe all you want, but I've got to just jump sideways as much as you'll let me.
Fair enough. Now, let me then ask you this, though. The Republican officials are divided on whether association with Mr. Nixon helps or hurts. We know, for instance, that Dean Birch said, in effect, a few days ago, the Republican Party is Nixon. And this tends to be harmonious with what Elliot Richardson said here a few months ago, that their fortunes are inseparable. Now, on the other hand, just a few days ago, Ray Bliss, one of your predecessors, said quite the contrary, that it certainly behooved Republican candidates to remove themselves as conspicuously as they could from what he considers to be apparently a political incubus. Now, as head of the Republican Party, is it uncomfortable for you to cooperate with people running for Congress on a I have nothing to do with Nixon ticket?
Well, I think we've got room in our party for diversity. It's not uncomfortable for me to cooperate with them. And my advice to them, and very few people seek it these days, but when they, if they do, I'll say, look, emphasize the good things that the administration has done, and jump up and down and say you don't like Watergate, that you're against it, you got all the answers for reform, you wouldn't have had anything to do with it, you were out here in Iowa and you weren't down there in Washington, and if you'd have been there, things would have been different. Be against the bad things, be for the good things.
Well, was that tried out in these any of these last five of
elections? Yeah, it was tried with varying. You can't ever have success unless you win. But in California, where the guy was up against five Democrats, all of whom were jumping up and down saying, Watergate's evil, Watergate's bad, elect me, Watergate's bad. Mm-hmm. And I said, how do you feel about Social Security? Well, I hate Watergate. And they had five of them doing it. The fellow won without a runoff. Some say, oh, yeah, but he should have won by 70% instead of 52. Maybe so. But he also had other issues that were not, from a national perception thing, not going his way. And I think in Michigan 8, the candidate tried to emphasize, you know, his abhorrence to things that go wrong. I would have to concede that there is much more linkage in the minds of the public than I thought a year ago and than I think is fair. Mm-hmm. It's there, and on the other hand, I don't think it's right or fair. I don't think the we've always thought in the Republican Party that the kinds of things that Watergate connote were almost the exclusive property of the Democrats. Big city machine kind of dead people voting in South Texas and all these kind of intriguing things that are still go on, regrettably, and nobody seems overly excited about. And I'm not saying, that makes Watergate okay. I'm just saying from an idealistic standpoint, we Republicans rather arrogantly felt that that kind of thing that we think of as Watergate was somebody else's property. But I think it's, and my view is that we, when you don't have a presidential, leave out Watergate, when you don't have a presidential year, and thus the umbrella of lots of issues over every race, there is much more room for diversity. There's much more room for people to take different positions. And certainly I would understand a candidate doing his own thing, so to speak, in terms of relationship to Washington.
Well,
none of them will be running against Nixon for eliminating the draft, however.
No.
None of them are going to say, well, you don't know how to handle you fouled things up in the Middle East. I mean, they're going to be talking about some of the good things, and they may be giving the president less credit than he deserves, depending on where he stands in the polls.
Sure. But isn't the problem that faces the conscientious voter correctly formulated as follows? I would expect Republican John Jones running for office and trying to solicit my vote to say that he abhors Watergate, because there isn't anybody in the world who says he loves Watergate, not even Howard Hunt. Mm-hmm. So, therefore, but pursuant to the axiom that who says A must say B, what they want to hear from him is what are the implications of Watergate as regards the leader of your party. To take an extreme example, you couldn't say, I hate anti-Semitism, but I love Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. And it is now established by these tapes that Mr. Nixon, who on the 30th of April classified Bob Haldeman and John Ehrlichman as superb public servants, in fact knew that they had withheld from him information about people like Gordon Liddy and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So is this voter going to look to the candidate and say, okay, I know you hate Watergate, but are you sore at Nixon for not moving more adroitly to...
I think that'll be an issue, and some will be saying, well... And, of course, what will come fall, hopefully, some of what this Judiciary Committee is doing, and properly doing, looking into the impeachment of the president, given will be behind it. So people will also have some kind of... it might not be closed or finished, but there will be. It won't be static. It may not be as clear as the case of Maury Stans, but how many people, in fairness, sitting in this audience or listening to this program 2 weeks ago would have said with conviction, Maury Stans is innocent. He may have felt it, but he might have felt a little funny about saying it because he'd been hammered into his, I'll never forget, into his consciousness that the guy had done something wrong. Mm-hmm. Now, I remember a press conference a year ago. I was speaking to the Republican governors, and I came out of it. And it's like calling Central Casting, saying, send over an ugly press conference scene. Mm-hmm. I was kind of shoved back into a little room, lights, these felt-covered things, goosing me from the back, pushing me in the front, saying, now what are you going to say? You're saying the party didn't hurt. Now what are you going to say? Two cabinet officers indicted. I remained beautifully calm, and I said, you would have been proud of me. I'd have said, well, indictment does not mean conviction. Yeah, but it proves, you know, and they were all made up. And from that moment on, paper after paper, homing in, you know. Now you got to be, I got to be careful that I don't paint with too broad a brush, but there has been a cumulative, almost denouncement of say, Maury Stans. Mm-hmm. And it got into the consciousness of people. And only when that jury unanimously acquitted him was did people wake up and say, my God, you know, all along I thought this guy had done something wrong. Don't stop to analyze why. Now, shift it over into your other question. You have the Judiciary Committee moving. And I'm not sure the verdict will be as clear there as it is the jury, you know, on a case. But it's not static. I happen to think that the tapes, with all their ugliness, should have been released. I've publicly said over the last year that the more out the better and that kind of thing, and the release of the tapes the better. But certainly they create some problems, but they've answered some questions. And the shift, there's been a little shift now from some of the things that the president was accused of. And all I'm saying is the system, I get great confidence in it. It works, and the climate will be different in the fall, and each candidate, going back to your question, each candidate that is asked or that speaks out is going to be making his own platform or his own pronouncement based on the facts at the time.
Well, I'm sure that's the case, but it's also the case that nobody has yet discovered a successful formula, and that although we do have the exoneration of Mr. Stans, we don't yet have the exoneration of Mr. Mitchell.
That's because right, there's his pending
the real Watergate one is his big one. That's yet to come. And the tapes, of course, hurt rather than help Mr. Mitchell. So that at the rate at which people have been pleading guilty over the last year, we must assume that there will be more people rather than fewer who will have pled guilty by November. Now, since at this moment there has been an average loss of 17 points in the last five elections, and since projecting that, that means the loss of 100 seats, or over 50% of those we have in the House of Representatives. This is a major crisis for the Conservative Party. It may conceivably be a terminal crisis. George Gallup has said we should change the name of the party to the Conservative Party because conservative, the word, does not suffer the stigma that the Republican Party does with the lowest enrollment in recorded history.
So I would simply respond by saying that George Gallup, by numbers that approximate the most recent ones, in the fall of 19, or in, I believe it was in December of 1965, 10 months before the elections in 1966, had the figures showing about 48-29 in terms of would you vote Democrat or Republican. Now, I think, and sure enough, in the fall of 1966, those figures, to the contrary notwithstanding, we picked up seats, mm-hmm. 47 in the House and 4 in the Senate, I think. My judgment is, if the economic situation is better in the fall, energy situation is better in the fall, you don't get much credit, incidentally, for accomplishments in foreign policy. The only time people vote on that, the absence of war is not an issue. When you get a war there, it seems more of a, because people are more affected. Ending the draft doesn't seem to be, you don't get so much credit for that. But if these other issues, and including Watergate, goes along, and if indeed the president is not impeached because people feel he on that committee feel that there is no impeachable offense there,
and we
all three of these issues, none of them will be gone away, all three will be better, and happily we will avoid the predictions of, you know, avoid the the disaster that is widely predicted for us. And there's two other points. One of them is there is nothing in the polls that show that the country wants to move left. Nothing in any of them. If anything, it shows the other way. And any time, if any fair analysis, and it's not in focus when these incumbents aren't up, it's not in focus in special elections, they see that Congress moving more liberal, more further to left, the people won't want that. And then another point is, Congress is at a lower ebb in the polls than the president. That is Democratic failure. It's not perceived to be. It's perceived to be institutional failure. It's Democrat failure.
Maybe it's at a lower ebb for failure to have impeached Nixon.
Well, I don't think so. I think it's at a lower ebb for having not, people don't think it's doing anything.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe some of it's in that range, but I don't think so, because the polls I've seen don't show that the people want the president impeached.
Yeah.
They
do
want something done about the economy. They do want something done about energy. And so I would respectfully suggest that your reason isn't the reason.
Mm-hmm. You say the country doesn't want to move left, and I agree with you, but it is true that the man in Michigan 8 who defeated our man is sort of a flower child leftist, and for him to have won is it's self-interesting. It's interesting enough that a Democrat won, but for a sort of a Rolling Stone Democrat to have won is something else, isn't it?
It's a very discouraging thing, yeah. But again, I would emphasize and that in Michigan 8, you had, which was where the unemployment was tremendously high in the two heaviest voting areas, Saginaw and Bay City. It appeared that they and throw in, okay, something for Watergate. I don't know how much you measure it yet. I haven't seen the post analysis. That they would stomach even that flower child, if you let me repeat the expression, because of their concerns on these three issues. But in the fall, I happen to think when that whole Congress is up, when this guy comes home as an incumbent, and they say to him, how do you feel about the energy crisis? And he says, I hate Watergate and Nixon. They say, no, that's fine. You're an incumbent. You've been down here 8 months. What have you done to solve the problems of energy unemployment? No incumbents have been up in these special elections. I don't think it's going to be the same thing. I think that 21% in the polls rightfully is Democrat failure. It's not perceived to be. So when this guy comes home to Bay City and he goes down to the UAW hall, and they say to him, ask him about what his program is for it, I just don't think it's going to be enough for every incumbent to shout Watergate. In these races with no incumbents, not the Congress on trial, nobody thinking about whether it's good or bad to have a veto-proof Congress and all the horrors that implies for this country, the issue of Congress at a low ebb, veto-proof Congress, incumbency, none of these things have been tested.
Mm-hmm.
And when they are, I can't believe this country wants to think that addition of a couple of more Democrats is going to solve anything.
Well, let me try this thesis out on you. Suppose it were true that X number of American independent voters don't want to vote Republican because they think that association with the party stigmatizes them. But are conservative-minded. Is there a way in time between now and November that they can make felt their inclinations in such a way as to moderate the typical Democratic candidate, move him to the right? If we're going to have a responsive Congress, presumably it's going to reflect, roughly speaking, the will of the people. Now, I can understand people pouting against Nixon refusing to vote for his party. I can't understand they're doing so masochistically. So obviously the solution would be to move those Democrats in Congress on over towards the center,
you've got to have an awful strong back to be able to haul some of those people anywhere near the center, because
right.
What's going to happen?
But they take
I think
polls
what you're
too.
Underestimating...
They take polls too.
Sure they do. But what I think what you're underestimating is the fact that of course, in my highly partisan job, I'm not going to give up on trying to get people to recognize that the principles of the Republican Party, diverse though they may be, but the matrix of our party is closer to the heartbeat of this country than the Democrat. I'm going to keep on with that thing. But in the fall, I think the alternatives are going to be clearer, because I think you're going to have this whole question of the Congress itself up there and the whole question of incumbency. And I think that is something that will make us do better than people think. But in terms of building party, or in terms of changing people without participating in party, I think it's pretty hard to be effective that way, to compel
people. That's certainly over the short term, isn't it? It might work out over a period of 4 or 6 years or 8 years to move the axis of a party's position left or right. But to do it between now and November is not very easy, is it?
I think it's pretty darn difficult.
Yeah.
And I'm not one who, we may differ on this, but who sees out of the relative lowness at this point in terms of voter identification, see the emergence of an effective third party, or certainly the demolition of the existing second party, mm-hmm. I think first, but second party. Mm-hmm. I don't see that as an option, and maybe it's just because I'm looking kind of rather short-sighted over my shoulder at the failure of third parties to really be effective. They're more individual-oriented than they are party, it seems to me.
Well, of course, the Republican Party was born as a third party.
Yeah, it came. That was some time ago, but it was. But I'm looking back at the progressives or Wallace, the American Independent. Without Wallace, it wasn't a real force. With mm-hmm. Wallace, it was certainly a force that indeed might have accomplished some of the things that your question implied. How do you make people move philosophically, knowing that they got to get reelected? I think it did have that effect. I don't think it did without Wallace's visibility and leadership in the last election.
Yeah,
they had American Independent Party candidates, but they all kind of fizzled and fell by the wayside.
If Wallace were to cross the aisle and become a Republican, would he, in your judgment, bring much of the South with him formally into the Republican Party?
Well, I don't know. I have felt that people, to some degree, follow leaders. But in the case of John Connally, who's very popular in the state of Texas, there has not been much movement in the terms of so-called Connally people to officially identify as Republicans. Now, so I really don't know whether that would help or not. I'll take the state of Virginia, which has gone in a very short period of time from being a Democratic state to predominantly Republican state, at least in the national level. The happening didn't happen that way, follow an individual and shift over. It happened kind of the other way. Some individuals, like our present governor, came over as that trend got moving from electing people at the congressional level. So I don't know whether that would happen. I'm just not sure enough. I don't know that he has that much following in, say, the state of Texas with conservative Democrats.
Well, are you making a conscious effort to get people to cross the aisle in the South?
Well, we're making a conscious effort to get them to vote Republican, mm-hmm. and most of it, a lot of the states, you don't have actual registration. You do it by, you know, like my state is not you don't go in and register like you would in the state of Connecticut. You do it by your registration almost as your participation in a primary. We still are behind in terms of primary activity, competition within a primary, where I'd like to see us as a party, because I do think that tends to draw people in. And we're behind where I'd like to see us in terms of candidacies all up and down the level. Our problem in the South is that in a lot of places, people will vote Republican at a national level, say at the presidential level, but at the local level, they don't, because they say, well, I'm disenfranchising myself. I want to vote for my county commissioner, and you only have one guy up for five slots, you know. Mm-hmm. So we're in some areas, we're behind where I would like to see us as a party. Clearly, we got more organization to do.
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Joseph Onek is an attorney in Washington, D.C. Mr. Onek?
Mr. Bush, you said that you thought there was more linkage between Republican congressional candidates and the president and his problems than is fair. And I'm wondering whether that makes sense. For example, we recently had this almost party line vote in the Judiciary Committee in which the Republicans, I think, voted to uphold the fairly absurd position that the president should not turn over the best evidence. You had
Jerry
Ford.
Excuse me, what was the absurd position?
that the president should not be required to turn over the tapes. You had Gerry Ford getting on national television, I believe it was yesterday, and saying from what he has seen, he is sure beyond any doubt that the president is innocent, which I think suggests he can't chew gum and read at the same time. Now, I think the American voter looking at this is going to say, why shouldn't we link Republican, the vice president, and Republican congressional candidates with the president, since they seem in a way to be covering up for the president? I've heard very little moral outrage from Republicans since the transcripts have been released. Why shouldn't this linkage be made, particularly between those Republicans who are now in the House and Senate and who are doing very little about Watergate when they go back to the hustings?
It will be made to some degree, but none of these candidates, none of these people you talked about, none of these people running had a damn thing to do with Watergate. That was my point. And I, of course, don't accept your predicate that 18 people on the judiciary outvoted by 20, several of whom have already made up their mind, going along with George Meany and ACLU and the ADA, long before any evidence is out at all that the president ought to be impeached, outvoted 20 to 18, that these people are all stupid or all trying to cover up. I just don't accept that hypothesis. In fact, I don't quite understand why the Judiciary Committee, without the minority ranking member knowing why, meets at 7 o'clock at night. I'm troubled by some of the procedures. And I have been one who has not been jumping on it as a partisan operation at all. But when you start seeing some of those things happening, I don't accept your premise that these people are wrong to suggest that the whole issue of confidentiality and separation is specious. I just don't accept that. Now, we just have a different, and I have enough respect for those 18 people on Judiciary Committee to challenge your the predicate of your question.
Miss Susanna Lessard is a freelance writer for the Washington Monthly and the New Yorker. Miss Lessard.
Mr. Bush, we all agree that Republicans are all branded, whether fairly or unfairly. I don't want to know whether you feel that the country ideologically is more inclined to the right or the left, but simply what advice you would give to a young man who wanted to run as a Republican and came to you and rather cynically asked, would it be better for me to be a liberal Republican or a conservative Republican? In terms of image, which is better or less bad?
It's a good question, and I think I'd say to him, well, gee, really, you ought to decide what you want to be when you grow up before you run for Congress, because he ought to be motivated by some philosophical conviction. And we have in our party, hopefully, enough diversity that he should feel comfortable in either place. Now, I might get an argument from Mr. Buckley on that point, but I feel that he ought to know what clicks him, what makes him tick in politics. But in terms of the practical political question, I won't say what I think you want me to say, and that is liberal Republicans are going to have an easier time of it than conservative Republicans, because the country doesn't appear to be wanting to move way left. Now, having said that, a lot of people that are thought of as liberal Republicans are reactionaries compared to liberal Democrats. And so I would have to say, I'd say to the guy, look, be what you are. Be open.
Yes,
say what motivates you. What you think is the way to solve these problems. I mean, I don't think I couldn't help him at all if he didn't know what the heck he was.
Yes, well, Mr. Buckley suggested that the Republican Party might get out of its troubles by simply slapping the label conservative on it. He didn't really imply that they... Oh, I thought
I'm rather fussy about who uses the word conservative. I want a severe
admissions
test.
I was going to say I was disillusioned, but I'll...
References and everything.
it's a tough question, but I don't see that one is going to fare better than the other, and I think that really is what the question, at least that's what it conveyed to me.
The stigma, it hasn't sort of tilted in either direction, if you see what I mean.
I don't think so, because there is no repudiation in this of conservatism. Yeah. Because Watergate's a bad deal.
Goldwater's prestige is very high right now.
Yeah. Good example. And so is Dick Schweikert's in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, Agnew hurt conservatism more than Nixon, in my judgment.
Because
the traditional conservative political sin is greed. The traditional liberal sin is lust for power. so that Nixon's sins tend to be democratic sins, as you suggested a moment ago, in terms of progeny. Mr. Bob Kuttner, who's laughing over there, is in the Washington Post.
That's why he's laughing. No. Two questions.
Yeah,
Dean Birch, a couple of weeks ago at that party conference, gave a lengthy speech, the tagline of which was supposed to be, "We got to sink or swim with the president." Those weren't his exact words, but that was the gist of it. And judging by the absence of applause in the room, a lot of people concluded that given that premise, the party would probably sink with the president. Now, are you giving Republicans out in the country that advice that their fate is bound up with the president's fate?
No, I'm giving it the advice that I hope I've conveyed a little bit of today. Here, be for the good things and be against the bad.
But everybody's right for that.
Well, I think, you know, it's rather interesting to me that at that meeting, which incidentally was rather upbeat, and I'm not sure I got that impression from most of the reports of it, and I think that was very accurate reporting about that point in Birch's speech. And I think, but I don't really feel this is that big a problem. I think we got room for diversity. The elections are going to focus on fundamentals. And I don't think Republicans are near as divided as Democrats, and I don't think we've got the great problem that it's made to be. I mean, people are going to withhold judgment on the president. There's procedures underway. Some are saying he's getting an unfair shake. Others are saying, I don't like what I think has happened, but I want to see, you know, let these proceedings go forward. And it's much more, the party is much more unified on this than one gets. But I would also have to say that party is ongoing. After 1976, there's going to be a different president. No party is so inextricably interwoven with any individual, even the president or head of the party, that the party is going to go out of existence.
On the point of whether voters are going to vote their ideology or are going to vote against Watergate, there is another position, and that's that they're going to vote their pocketbook. And it's not that the Democrats are answering the question, what about the economy with Watergate? They've come up with rather a clever synthesis. They've said, he's so busy with Watergate, which I'm not mentioning, he's so busy with Watergate that he can't get his act together on all this other stuff, and the country's going to hell. And that seems to be a rather nimble formula for them to mention Watergate without mentioning Watergate. Now, here we have the chairman of the Republican Party saying in an election year with a Republican in the White House that the country has unacceptable rates of inflation and unemployment. Mm-hmm. And that statement on your part is just an admission of how terrible
problems.
Things are, that if that's the lesser evil, if 14% inflation and 5-point-something unemployment is the lesser evil, you got problems for November.
Well, Jesus, I didn't need you to tell me that. I know I got problems. But the problems are going to be laid at the foot in a congressional year with a non-presidential year at the Democrats.
Are
and
they?
My point is, it's not going to be good enough for some Democrat to get up in the fall and say, I hate Watergate. How do you feel? What did you do? What was your answer? Was your answer full controls? Well, I hate Watergate. I don't like it. It's not going to be good enough. These incumbents are going home. These incumbents are going to have to go home and answer to the people about the failure of the Congress if we do our jobs right campaigning. And that point has not been tested. Incumbency hasn't been tested. And Watergate's been tested, economy somewhat, without focus on Congress's action or inaction. And I just think that I don't see anything in the mood of this country to make it want to move over to what a veto-proof Congress would mean to the country. Now, people aren't yet focusing on
right.
it. We're early. I hope the Post will help us on this, because I hope you understand how bad it would be for our country if we had a veto-proof Congress. Very bad.
I don't think it's exactly correct that the Washington Post didn't give an upbeat slant to that meeting. Its headline was, GOP ends parley hoping to survive.
Assuming that the president will be impeached by the House, would it be better or worse for Republican candidates if the Senate trial takes place before or after the election? There seems to be some question about when that Senate trial might take place, but let's assume for the moment that there is going to be a trial. Would it be better before or after?
I don't think there's going to be a trial, and my only observation would be that it ought not to be done in any way where people would perceive it to be politically motivated. It's wrong for our country, it's wrong for our system, transcendent of party. It's bad if it got, if there was even the perception that it was being scheduled so as to help the Democrats win elections. I don't think the leadership of the United States Senate would be that irresponsible. And beyond that, I don't know. I think people want to see the system work. And I don't think that's going to happen, that it would be scheduled. I think it would be best if, you know, in terms of politics of it, that the Judiciary Committee promptly move, and from the way I see it, promptly decide not to impeach the president. I think that's what they're going to do in final analysis.
Here's a question I don't know the answer to. I'm sure you do, and if you don't, I'm sure Mr. Honeck does. If the impeachment trial in the Senate passes beyond the election and on into the next term,
who votes?
Do the old senators vote or the new senators?
Heavens, I don't know. And then you'd have to start all over with that. I just don't know how that works.
I assume you'd have to start all over, although maybe you could use the transcript, but I don't see how certainly the old senators couldn't vote. It would have to be the new. Now, they could maybe use
Would you have to have fresh articles of impeachment voted?
You've got me. But I tend to doubt that, and sometimes...
The new Congress.
Do you know, Mrs. Saad, the answer
to that?
Because I don't know that. Do you?
No, I don't. There were two go-arounds with Andrew Johnson. That took place over two different Congress.
But the first was never voted. He was impeached in March and exonerated in May of 68. So that would have been a single.
Different Congress which took it up again. They didn't rely
on the first one wasn't voted.
I see your point.
So it may then be that as a practical matter, you would have to do what? Suppose he was impeached in June, and suppose the estimate was that it would take 4 or 5 months to transact the trial, would you have to sort of start it right away, even though it would span the election, on the grounds that otherwise...
It can span the election, it just can't go beyond January 2nd, so that if you started in September...
But then we get in the way of Mr. Bush's point that you don't want to have it going on during election because it would look as though it was phony, right?
Well, I say if it were done that way, I think the system was orderly, and I don't know what the procedures were, okay, it's going to take us 2 weeks now to assess this and move into the Senate. People, even if that meant going through the elections, I don't think people would perceive an orderly process to be politically motivated. But if somebody said, okay, the House is... sent over a bill of impeachment in June, and they say, well, we'll tell you what we'll do. We'll have the kickoff under the floods. A good date would be October 22nd. I think people might think, I wonder if there's any politics involved. I don't think it's going to happen. The Senate leadership is too responsible.
It could be the anniversary of when Lyndon Johnson suspended the bombing.
Democrat and Republican. And I just don't believe it's going to, and I like to think that the Judiciary Committee, going back to Mr. Hanek's question, is going to have fewer of those kind of partisan votes, but I refuse to accept that when they happen, all Republicans are bad guys fooling around. How about the woman under the big hat that's been saying they ought to throw the president out for months, for heaven's sake, before she had any evidence.
Are you suggesting there's no White House pressure on the Republicans on that committee, and if they were given a free vote?
Yeah, I am suggesting that.
And if they were given a free vote,
Not only suggesting it, but I know it.
And a free vote would have come out exactly the same way. It's just coincidental.
Absolutely.
Just coincidental that all but one Republican voted as he or she did.
Is it coincidental that all the Democrats voted against?
No, I'm not sure it is. But the question is,
did you put pressure on the Democrats to vote as a bloc?
I certainly didn't.
Well, who did?
The Washington Post?
Absolutely.
Ms. Lassard?
Yes, Mr. Bush, you disturbed me when you alluded to the old picture of the Democrats as the big city machine and the dead people voting and all that.
That's my own feeling of how the core of the corruption came from. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. Well, that certainly was. I mean, the Democrats are crooks and the Republicans were the I've heard Republicans do this before, and it strikes me as a very poor strategy at any rate, because it sends shivers down one spine, because most of us, I think, agree that there's a qualitative difference between what happened, not the break-in, but what happened afterwards, and the usual kind of underhanded democratic...
These are kind of stealing elections and dead people voting.
Yes,
and corruption,
yes.
Of robbing and getting rich on the from stealing from cities and
yes.
stuff. Yeah,
yes.
There is a difference. I think
Would you tell me what how you see that difference?
I see both of them is very bad for our system. Both of them just as wrong as they can be. I think both from... I'm motivated. You won't believe this. But, you know, I was living happily out of politics, and I got involved in it for certain idealistic reasons. And my idealism has been all challenged and all mixed up by the ugliness of Watergate. I think it's wrong. I don't like the people that have kind of, and I don't want to prejudge some trial still going on, but I don't like it. I don't like that thing. But I am not, I can't seem to come to the point that, well, it's all right to steal from a city. It's all right to vote to steal an election. Possibly steal a presidential election, and that's one kind of corruption, but the kind of corruption attributed to people breaking into Larry O'Brien's telephone is so much worse. Can't accept it. Sorry.
Well, what about not breaking in and...
Listening to this little guy talking about whatever it was he was talking to on the telephone. That's what I'm talking about, breaking into water, or covering up the fact
or
that had happened.
Or tampering the agencies. Let's take that.
Don't like that either.
Well,
offended
by
it.
Do you put
not sure I know the facts on it. System will bring that out.
Yes. But do you put that in a different category of horror than, say,
it's awful
even
hard to quantify my moral indignation, but I find it a little troubling that some people are so deeply offended about those allegations you just talked
yes.
to and are untroubled,
by
unwilling to investigate.
By sending FBI agents to steal representatives at 5 o'clock in the morning, for instance.
I'm offended by all of it.
Tends to be manipulating the agencies, doesn't it?
Yes, I suppose. What I mean is that I think we would both agree that the idea that it was just bad luck, the Republicans got caught, this kind of thing happens in politics all the time,
is
an extremely unsophisticated notion that anybody who knows... I haven't talked to any veteran of politics who would agree with that. They would say this is a new... This is a new level that we're into here. This is there's
well, look, I
an
think
escalation
that,
of so.
I think well, it's wrong. I think it offends me. I don't like to go home and see my kids turned off from the political process from reading about this. I'm troubled by it deeply, individually. Everybody that knows me and personally, I think, knows that. All of which is unimportant in terms of. I'm just trying to air my own view, so you won't think that Republicans are kind of rationalizing Watergate by saying we don't like what's been going on for years in some of the big cities or in some of the elections. But I am a little amazed at some of the morality, the moral judgments being made that this is just unparalleled in our history. How do we know?
Oh,
who
well,
else has had his bared his soul like this? Who else? Do you think there are ever expletives issued by Lyndon Johnson?
Oh.
Or anything else that might have been
certainly
looked into?
Not.
How would a Bay of Pigs look in 1974?
I'm not talking about expletives.
Well, what are we talking about?
I'm talking about the kind of abuse of power where you see...
Well, let's go back to the Bay of Pigs. Analyze it microscopically. Look at it carefully. Did that offend your morality at the time? Were you just giving up on your government and all its institutions because you were so deeply offended by what we did in the Bay of Pigs?
She was in kindergarten during the Bay of Pigs. Huh?
Yeah, but she's very bright. She probably was...
I was very offended by the Bay of Pigs, not for...
You've written some stuff on it lately to show the prostitution of government agencies?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I did.
Well, I'd love to see it because
not
it hadn't get the Post to print it because they haven't done a good job on it.
Are you sorry?
You see my point at all?
Watergate? Is that what you're saying?
Huh?
Are you sorry that the Post broke Watergate? Are you sorry?
No. I'm sorry that Watergate exists. It offends
but
me.
But given the fact that it exists, are you sorry
me.
That it was exposed?
Absolutely not. I want to see it out, examined, laid to rest in the system.
You think the
not through suggesting that, incidentally, that through the leak or the innuendo or the preconception or the kind of secret grand jury thing leaked a little ahead of time through the system. That's what I want to see happen. And I think it's happening. And long after people can't remember how you spell Strawn or whatever Manet might have been fairly or unfairly dragged into it, they're going to remember that the system does indeed work. And hopefully out of it will come some meaningful reform, not the Washington Post version of turning it all over to the federal government. That isn't the answer. But some meaningful reform in terms of campaign financing or whatever it is. and hopefully a reawakening of a certain moral sense. But this latter-day recognition, or this suggestion that the breaking into the Democratic headquarters is something so much, and the attendant things there too, I'll give you that, is so much worse than anything else that's ever happened, or that makes people all corrupt, and then they link in two cabinet officers, one of whom has now been acquitted. I just can't accept it. And I'm more troubled about it than you are. It's made my life a hell of a lot more complicated than yours, too.
It's made yours much more enjoyable, hasn't it?
I've only been there for a week. This is the first time I've ever represented the Washington Post. How is it that executive privilege permits the president to release all of this pounds and pounds of stuff on the Watergate break-in and the cover-up, but doesn't permit him to release any of the stuff on the 50-some-odd other counts, on ITT, on milk, on tax?
I'm not sure that legal, the decision is strictly that doctrine in its legal confines. I don't know. You have to ask a lawyer. I'm not a lawyer on that.
But he has chosen to release, he's chosen to tell the committee that their investigation of the break-in and the cover-up is, in his eyes, legitimate, but their investigation of all these other counts does not entitle them to material that he considers privileged. Why that distinction?
I don't know. I think we'll have to wait and see what the system does to that. As I saw, there was could well be an appeal in the courts. And let's see what the courts determine. Let's see how it works. See whether there is such a doctrine.
There must be some answer that satisfies the Judiciary Committee, because they have not, in fact, subpoenaed this other material.
I don't know the answer.
So apparently they are satisfied by whatever distinction the White House has drawn, right?
No, they're not. I mean, they haven't gotten around to it yet. They're still hassling over the Watergate material.
Well, my understanding was Mr. Rodina wanted to throw out those other counts.
No, some of them, not all of them.
Not all of them, yeah.
The frivolous.
Bombing of Cambodia, I think, is that.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Bush, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel, and thank you all for coming.
Next week on Firing Line, prominent Washington attorney Edward Bennett Williams joins Mr. Buckley for an exchange of ideas on justice and the Fifth Amendment. Printed bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.